Continue with Lattice QCD, please.
Okay, thanks. Can you hear me? No. Okay. So today we will continue. Just with Lattice QCD. And the lecture of this morning is dedicated to explain this number here in the spectrum, eta prime, and we will see why it's important. Okay, so the mass of the particle eta prime. And in particular, that is related to the anomalous breaking of the U1 axial symmetry, which is here in QCD. So yesterday, we saw that one possible regularization of fermions on the lattice is what is called the Wilson action or the Wilson regularization, which is just defined as the naive discretization plus an higher order operator, an higher order operator of dimension 5. And yesterday we were just looking at the free case. Now, if you want to do the interacting case, what you have to do is that the forward and the backward derivative, the forward and the backward derivative, you have just to promote to be sort of covariant derivative of the continuum. So here, when you make the shift, you have to put a link, u mu x. And when you make the negative shift here, you have to shift with the dagger of the link. Okay, this is the analogous of the covariant derivative in the continuum. Okay, but we have also commented yesterday that this breaks chiral symmetry, and this makes everything not very transparent at the theoretical point, from the theoretical point of view. So there is another possibility of regularizing the fermions on the lattice, which is given by fermions which satisfy the Gisbard-Wilson relation, and this is the relation I was showing before. D, I still didn't find what is, in this case, the Dirac operator. And in fact, it took almost 15 years. The relation, as I said yesterday, is of 82. And then in a Berger operator is of 98. And this operator is defined like this. It's defined 1 over the lattice spacing times 1 plus gamma 5 q divided square root of q square, where q is nothing else than the Wilson operator with a gamma 5 in front and with a negative mass, which is minus 1 plus s. It's the same 1 plus s which appears here. So what you have to take, okay, this is a nice way to write it. Otherwise, you can put here directly, you see there is a gamma 5 and a gamma 5 here. You can put directly here the Wilson-Dirac operator with negative mass, and then here is the square root of d dagger d, okay? Now we started with an operator which is ultra-local, because you see this is connect just to two nearest neighbor points. And here you have a term which is ultra-local because it's the Dirac operator, gamma 5 is local. But then there is the inverse of the square root of an ultra-local operator. And this quantity here, in general, if you take a matrix and you make the inverse of the square root of the square, is not a sparse matrix, a local operator, but this is in general is a full matrix. And therefore, the operator will be completely non-local. And this we don't want, because we want to regularize QCD with a local operator here. But actually, you can prove that what I said in general, it's true, but with the following condition. You can prove that if you take the norm of the matrix at a distance x and y on the lattice, what you get is that this is proportional to e to the minus c over a times the distance between the two points. And now you see, so this means that this matrix here is a full matrix, but when you go away from the diagonal of this matrix here, the off-diagonal term decreases exponentially with the distance from the diagonal, okay? And the important point here is that the coefficient of the exponent increase when the lattice spacing goes to zero. So this is an exponentially local operator, and when you take the continuum limit, becomes a local operator, okay? And since it's exponentially local at finite lattice spacing, for what concerns the application of all the field theory theorems, they apply, okay? Because there, when we want to talk about power divergences and so on, they are not affected by an exponential behavior of this type. So from the point of view of the field theory, you can just forget that D is not a strict ultra-local operator, but is a local operator and is as good as an ultra, is a local operator and is as good as an ultra-local operator. Okay? So we can forget this part here. And now what we can do, so now we know that there is this relation, there is a solution of it, which is a good regularization of QCD, and now we can recover the anomaly in the simplest possible form that one can recover it. So let's take now a U1 axial transformation, so it's a subgroup of the chiral group. And let's make the usual transformation. Psi prime is equal to psi plus I. I will put a zero on top of it because today we will have also the non-singlet transformation, okay, today and this evening and this after. So gamma 5 at psi. And then we can have psi bar prime is psi bar plus E epsilon 0 A psi bar gamma 5. Ah, sorry, I have to define. Sorry, there is an extra. Okay. So let's define now a matrix gamma 5 at, which is defined as 1 minus A bar D. And you can prove now that if you define this gamma 5 at, this relation here, this is just trivial, this definition shows you that the Gisbert-Wilson Dirac operator satisfies this form of chiral symmetry relation, okay? So what you get is that, you see, what you get, okay, gamma 5D, and then here, one of the A bar D, you put in the definition of gamma 5 at, and then you get this relation here, okay?
The hat is really over the second
one? Yeah, it's only one, absolutely.
Okay,
this is a crucial point, okay? So it's only on one of them. Okay, so you see that the relation when we were stating the Nielsen-Inomiya theorem, we had gamma 5d plus d gamma 5 equal to 0. Now the Gisbert-Wilson relation, what changed that relation here and replace it with gamma 5 at. Okay. Now how it's done gamma 5 at. The important point of gamma 5 at is that you see from here. It this time depends on the gauge field. Okay, while in the continuum, the chiral symmetry, you're used to use only gamma 5, which is independent on the gauge field. In this case, one of the gamma 5, the gamma 5 at, depends on the gauge field here. And this is how the anomaly will be generated. Okay? Now, this symmetry here. This symmetry here is also called the Luscher symmetry that was found in 98. Okay, so once we have this gamma 5 at, we can define on the lattice the U1 axial transformation, which are defined like this. And the gamma 5 at acts on the quarks, while the standard gamma 5 acts on the anti-quarks. Okay? And now again, if you make this transformation infinitesimal and you compute the variation of the action, then the variation of the action is minus a to the fourth I epsilon 0 a sum over x of psi bar gamma 5 d plus d gamma 5 at. Okay? And now see the massless action. And now since this satisfies the Gisbert-Wilson relation, this is equal to 0. Okay? Okay, so now we know that the action written with this operator here is chiral symmetric, and now we have to see what happened in our path integral to the measure, okay? So at the classical level, we have exact chiral symmetry, but then at the quantum level, What we have to do, we unitarize this transformation here, as usual. So this becomes psi prime e to the I epsilon a zero gamma 5 at psi. And psi bar prime is equal to e to psi bar e to the I epsilon a zero gamma 5. And now we need to compute the Jacobian of the transformation. So d psi bar d psi prime. This will be equal to, now when you have fermions and you integrate over Grassmann variable, you have to remember that the transformation is with the inverse of the Jacobian, not with the Jacobian, okay? Now if you do that, what you get from those transformations is the determinant of e to the I epsilon a zero gamma 5 times 1 over the determinant of e to the I epsilon 0 a gamma 5 at, okay? And then d psi bar d psi, okay? And now here you use the usual trick of doing the determinant of the exponential with the exponential of the trace, and what you get at the end is d psi prime is equal to e to the minus I epsilon 0 a trace of gamma 5 at, and then there will be the same with the trace of gamma 5, but the trace of gamma 5 is 0 because this is just the standard gamma 5, okay, times d psi bar d psi, okay? So you see that now what we have is that we have exact chiral symmetry, so the action is, the massless action is chiral invariant, but now the measure is not anymore chiral invariant. So the classical theory is chiral invariant, but the quantum theory is not chiral invariant. And it's not chiral invariant by this term here, okay? So now let's look how it's done that term. So gamma 5 at is defined here. So when you take the trace of gamma 5 at, okay. So when you do trace of gamma 5 at, you get trace of gamma 5, so this is 0, but then you get minus a bar trace of gamma 5d, okay? And now we can define, let's define, for the moment is a definition, qx I define as minus a bar divided by 2, trace of gamma 5 dxx, okay? This is the little trace, so this is just the trace on spin and color, okay? And now, and we can define something which is the integral of q, like this. And now you see immediately that, now if you take also now the sum over x, of this quantity, you get also the trace, sum over x means that you get also the trace over the space-time indices here. And so what you can prove is that this quantity q is equal to 1 half of trace of gamma 5 at. Okay? So at the end of the story, what you get there is that d psi prime d psi prime is equal to e to the minus I 2 epsilon 0 a from here trace of gamma 5 q times d psi bar psi, okay? Now this quantity here, what is qx? Now this quantity here it's written as a trace over color spin indices, but you, since D is a local operator, you can see this quantity as a pure glonic operator. Okay, it's written in the form of the trace of a Dirac matrix, but actually from the point of view of the field theory, this is a purely glonic operator because it depends only on f mu nu in a local way. And in fact, what you can do now, you can do exactly what we have done for the gluon action at the beginning, and you, so insert here the definition of the links like e to the minus e a, the lattice spacing times a mu, you make a lot of lengthy computation, and what you get at the end is that the q of x when e goes to zero, goes like 1 over 32 pi square, epsilon mu nu rho sigma of trace, little trace, on, only on color this time, f mu nu f rho sigma. So this is nothing else than what usually you're used to see ff tilde. Okay? So this is the anomalous part of on the this is also called the topological charge operator, and it's the term which generates the anomalous term in the word identities for QCD. Okay? So now this is a crucial point. So if there are questions, it's a good time to ask. So the important point of all this, of all this construction, is that the main point is that you have still a chiral symmetry, a finite lattice spacing, but the gamma, the generator of this symmetry, or if you like, the gamma 5, in one case is replaced by gamma 5 hat, which is a matrix which still acts in Dirac, on the Dirac indices, but depend on explicitly on the gauge field. So configuration by gauge field by background, this matrix here changes. It's not like in the continuum, okay? But you can still define a complete chiral symmetry for U1 or for the non-singlet one, we will see. The action is symmetric. So when you write the path integral for the fermions, this part here is fully symmetric, so it's invariant under chiral symmetry. While this part here, so when you quantize the theory, is not anymore symmetric, it gets a Jacobian, and the Jacobian is exactly e to the minus I to epsilon A, the topological charge. Okay? But I want to stress again that here there is no black magic. Eh? It's not like the Fujikawa method that you have to regularize the Dirac operator and so on. This is just you do algebra here, there is nothing else. The crucial point is that this operator is local, even though it doesn't look local explicitly. Okay. So now let's see. Now it's useful to look at the spectrum of the operator. Okay, you can prove that, so let's look at the spectrum of D. And we will use only the Gisbert-Wilson relation to look at. So you can rewrite A bar D. Now if you look at the definition of gamma 5 hat, it's nothing else than A bar D is gamma 5 hat. Okay, you can write like that. And also you can also prove by using the definition that gamma 5 hat times its dagger is equal to 1. Okay? So the product of the two gamma 5s, it's a unitary operator. This means that the eigenvalues A lambda, the eigenvalues lambda bar of D, okay, you can rewrite them as like 1 minus e to the I alpha, okay? This is also, this operator D, using the Gisbert-Wilson, you can prove that also commute with the D dagger. So this is an operator that you can diagonalize. It's just a, okay, it's a complex operator, but the real part and the imaginary part commute among themselves, okay? So now, once you have written this in this form, you realize immediately that the eigenvalues are of three types. There are zero eigenvalues, they can be zero eigenvalues for when alpha here, when e to the I alpha is equal to zero, or they can be eigenvalues which are 2 over A, okay, or they can be just complex eigenvalue. So the eigenvalue lies on a circle, okay, which is centered in 1, touched 0, and touched 2 over A bar. Okay. So now let's look at the first case. So lambda bar is equal to 0. So if lambda bar is equal to zero, then we can use the Gisbert-Wilson relation and say that gamma 5d plus d gamma 5, the eigenvector of lambda bar, this guy here is equal a bar d gamma 5d u of lambda. Okay. But now, since we are looking at u of lambda where lambda bar is equal to zero, this is equal to zero, and this is equal to zero. Okay. So this means that d gamma 5 u of lambda, this is equal to zero. So if there is an eigenvector u of lambda which has lambda bar equal to zero, then also gamma 5 u of lambda is an eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda bar equal to zero. So either there is only one of these u lambdas, or if there are more, you can diagonalize the gamma 5 matrix with the subspace of eigenvector with eigenvalue equal to zero, and then you can always choose those eigenvectors so that u gamma 5 u lambda is equal plus or minus u lambda. Okay. So this shows that the eigenvector associated with the null eigenvalues are chiral, okay, either chirality plus or chirality minus. And we will call this eigenvector n plus minus. So n plus is the number of eigenvectors with chirality plus, and n minus the number of eigenvectors with chirality minus. Okay, now let's look at the other case. So there is a case where lambda bar is equal to 2 over a bar. Now we can repeat the same. So gamma 5d plus d gamma 5 u lambda equal to a bar d gamma 5d u lambda. Okay, and now we use here what we can use is, so we have d gamma 5 u lambda. And now gamma 5d u lambda here, we can replace with 2, sorry, d u lambda we can replace with 2 over a. And therefore, and that at the end what you get is that d gamma 5 u lambda is equal to 2 over a bar gamma 5 u lambda. Okay, you just replace d u lambda is 2 over a, d u lambda is 2 over a, you put things together, and what you get is that the eigenvector, the vector which is gamma 5 u lambda is still an eigenvector of d with the same eigenvalues of u lambda. So also the eigenvalues with the real eigenvalues, so with lambda bar equal 2 over a bar, also this one we can do the same exercise as we did here. And then also for this eigenvalue, we can say that gamma 5 u lambda is equal plus or minus u lambda, okay? And we will call n plus or minus prime, okay? So now we are left with the last sector. And this is the sector where lambda is complex. So a lambda bar, in this case, is 1 minus e to the I alpha. We repeat the same, gamma 5 d plus d gamma 5 u lambda is equal a bar d gamma 5 d u lambda. And now if you plug in this definition here, and you know the little algebra, what you get is d gamma 5 u lambda is equal to lambda bar divided a lambda bar minus 1 gamma 5 u lambda, okay? But then now if you here, you put this definition here, what you notice is that this quantity here is nothing else than the lambda bar star, okay? It's the complex conjugate. Okay, so this is telling you that if you have an eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda, then you must have an eigenvector which is gamma 5 u lambda with eigenvalue lambda star, lambda bar star. Okay, so the complex eigenvalues come in couples, lambda star, And the eigenvector are related, like U of lambda star is gamma 5 U of lambda. And now, since this is a diagonalizable matrix, this also tells, then this eigenvector must be orthogonal to U lambda. And so in particular, this tells you that U lambda gamma 5 U lambda is equal to 0. Okay? So you see how it's done the spectrum of this operator in any gauge field background. There are some chiral eigenvectors. Some have lambda bar equal to 0, and some have lambda bar equal to 2 over A bar. And then there are some complex eigenvalues. They come in complex conjugate pairs. And they are such that their eigenfunctions, their eigenvectors, have zero chirality. Okay, when you compute gamma 5 on them, the chirality of this eigenvector is equal to 0. Okay? Now, if you remember in the continuum, you may have lambda bar equal to 0, the zero mode of the Dirac operator, but then the other modes are I lambda, so are pure imaginary eigenmodes, and they come in pairs, I lambda and minus I lambda. Now, in the case of the lattice, what happens is that you get also a real part, and this real part is a discretization effect. Okay? Okay, so now with this, so just remember, the important things is that these modes here are chiral, the other modes have chirality zero. I mean, this is the most important information. So now we can take the expression for the anomaly. And in particular, we want to look at trace of gamma 5 hat, which is A bar gamma 5D, okay? And now this you can also write as trace of gamma 5 A bar D minus 2. Okay, why you can write like this? Because the minus 2 makes zero contribution, because it's trace of gamma 5, which is 0, okay? But now you see that in this part here, what are the modes that contribute? It contributes for sure the mode with eigenvalues equal to 2, okay? The mode with eigenvalues equal to 0 doesn't contribute to the trace, and the complex conjugate modes, they do not contribute because when you do the trace, this, if you put here, you know, lambda bar U lambda U lambda, here when you make the trace, you compute U lambda gamma 5 U lambda, which is 0 on these modes because they have zero chirality. So on this part here, so on the left side, the only modes which contributes are the one with 2. And what you get here, therefore, is 2 times n plus prime minus n minus prime. And if I didn't do mistakes, there should be a 2 here. No, there is no 2. Sorry, it's like this. Now, if you instead look at this expression here, okay, you see that the 2 modes, they do not contribute because they cancel. The complex mode, they do not contribute because they cancel for the same reason before. But the 0 modes, they do contribute, okay, because the 0 modes here gets a minus 2 here, okay? And this means that here, what you get is 2 times n plus minus n minus, with the minus sign here. There is a minus 2 there. Okay? So you see that the difference between the zero mode with chirality plus minus the zero mode with chirality minus is the opposite of the modes on the other side. Okay? So these modes here are completely in the ultraviolet. Okay? They have values at the level of the cutoff, but they know about the topology, okay? Because they know about this, the difference of the number of these modes here. Okay. So now let's put this expression here in the variation of the measure. So what we get at the end is that d psi prime, d psi bar, we say this e to the minus 2i epsilon a0 trace of q, And now if you put that result in, d psi bar, if you put that result in, Q is nothing else than the number of chiral modes with chirality plus minus the number of chiral modes with chirality minus, okay? And this is nothing else than what you call the index theorem for topology, okay? There are questions on this? Okay. This is an important result. And the crucial point to recover these results is again that the chiral symmetry depends on the gauge field. Okay. Now we can define our continuous transformation and recover the word identities. Sorry. Okay, now before I go in the computation, what is the goal? There is an equation which is called the Witten-Veneziano, let's write it there, which is called the Witten-Veneziano equation or relation. Which tells the following. It tells you that if you take the limit where number of color goes to infinity and the limit of massless quarks of f pi square m eta prime square divided 2nf, this is equal to the limit of number of colors that goes to infinity of the topological susceptibility in the Young-Mills theory. Okay? Okay, now we will see in some detail how to recover this relation, but it's important before deriving it to see where we want to go, because then the computation starts to be a bit difficult. Now if you didn't have the anomaly, you can, for the U1 axial symmetry, you can do exactly what we will do for the other symmetry, okay? And then you can prove that the pseudoscalar meson associated to the generator of the U1 axial symmetry is a Goldstone boson, okay? So you would prove that the mass of the eta prime would be equal zero in absence of anomaly, okay? But you can also prove through the word identities that the anomaly vanishes in the limit where nc goes to infinity. So in particular, limit where nc goes to infinity of m eta prime in the chiral limit is equal to zero, okay? Now, the Witten-Veneziano formula here, what provides? It provides the first non-trivial correction to the mass of data prime due to the anomaly. So you know that due to the anomaly, the mass of data prime will be proportional to 1 over nc plus higher order correction in 1 over nc, okay? Now, this quantity here is order 1, because this quantity is order nc. This quantity is order of 1 over nc, so this quantity here is of order 1 in 1 over nc counting, and this quantity is order 1, okay? So the topological susceptibility, which is defined, chi is defined as d for x, as q of 0, exactly, or if you like, on the lattice, this would be a to the fourth sum of x. And this q of x is exactly the q of x that we derived that way, okay? So Witten and Veneziano, they say, in 79, they say that the leading term in 1 over nc generated by the anomaly for the mass of data prime is dictated by the topological susceptibility divided f pi square, okay? And this is a very important relation for lattice. Why? Because this relation checks the quantization of the theory at the non-perturbative level. Because we know that if there was no quantization, there was no anomaly, and therefore the mass of data prime would not be there. Okay? There is a mass of data prime in nature different from zero because there is the anomaly. But the mass of data prime is generated only by non-perturbative effects. So the test of the Witten-Veneziano formula is crucial because it is the test of the quantization of QCD at the non-perturbative level. When you see the running of the coupling, for instance, you are checking there the quantization of the theory at the, at the perturbative level. When you look at the mass of data prime, you check the quantization of the theory at the non-perturbative level. Okay, so this is a crucial check for QCD more than for lattice. Okay, so in the next hour or so, we will derive in a rigorous way this relation here, and then we will see how we can compute this on the lattice. Okay. Okay, first of all, there are some definitions. So we can define, like we do in the continuum, p hat is, you can imagine what it is, 1 plus or minus gamma 5 hat. So this is the projector with chirality plus or minus for the fermions. And then we will need for the psi bar, we will need also 1 half of 1 plus or minus gamma 5. And we can define the chiral multiplets, left and right, which is, for the case of fermions, is with p hat, and for the case of antifermions, is psi bar p minus plus. Remember that if here there is p plus minus, so we define right and left this way, here is flipped, okay, for the antifermions. Okay, and then we can define the u1 right times u1 left transformations. And these are just defined as usual. You take your psi left and you rotate with a phase. And you take psi bar left prime and you rotate the psi bar left with VL dagger. Okay? And you make the same for the right, but with a different matrix. Okay? So this is exactly like in the continuum, with the only difference that in this projector now you have gamma 5. Now you can define, having defined all this, you can define, for instance, bilinear, we will use later, with the correct pseudoscalar scalar, with the correct chiral symmetry under this symmetry here. So they are a little bit modified. So a generic bilinear will be defined like this, okay? Now, since here we have gamma 5 at, you have to put a tilde, and the psi tilde is nothing else than 1 minus a bar d divided by 2 psi. I mean, this term here, how you get this term here? You write your bilinear in terms of component left and right of fermions, and with the gamma. For instance, the scalar is psi left, psi right, plus psi right, psi left. The pseudoscalar has the minus between the two. Okay, and for psi left and psi right, you use this definition here. You put all together, and what you get at the end, you see that the standard bilinear gets modified by this term here, which comes from here. Nothing special. Okay, and then we can now define, these are the chiral transformations, so we can define the axial and the vector subgroup of those transformations, and in particular the vector is defined so that the two rotations, left and right, are the same, and they are e to the I epsilon a 0, while the chiral, the axial is defined, the one that we are interested in, is defined so that v left dagger is equal to v right, so the phase of the rotation is opposite, e to the I epsilon 0 vector axial. Okay? And also, now by having defined these multiplets, we know how to introduce a mass with the Gisbert-Wilson regularization. We know that the mass couple left with right, okay? And so the massive action So the massive action can... can be defined as a to the fourth sum over x of psi d psi, this is the massless that we saw, plus m dagger psi left, plus psi left m psi right. In all our lectures, we will use the simplification that m is equal to m dagger, which is equal to m times the identity. So our quarks will be always degenerate. And in the mass term m, in general, there is no phase. Okay. Now you see that thanks to the Gisbard-Wilson relation, if you apply this chiral symmetry here, we showed before, this is chiral invariant. Okay. So this, the variation of this guy is zero. Now this term here is not chiral invariant because there is a mass term which breaks it. Okay. But if you make also the so-called spurion transformation, exactly like you do in the continuum, so you make the transformation that when you rotate the fields, you rotate also the mass term. So m dagger goes, if you rotate it, m dagger prime equal v right m dagger v left dagger. And m gets rotated with v left m v right dagger. This is why I distinguish mm and dagger, because these two terms, they rotate in a different way. Okay? So now if on top of, this, of the fermions, you rotate also the parameter, the mass parameters, then this action remains invariant. Now, there is an important point here. This doesn't mean that the theory is invariant under chiral symmetry, because when you rotate the parameter in your action, you're changing theory, okay? But what you can do when the theory is not invariant through the spurion transformation, you can connect two different theories, okay? A theory with a mass which is m with a theory with a mass which is m prime. While if the action is invariant, the theory is invariant because it's the same theory, okay? So this is not anymore a symmetry transformation, but you can do this. It's useful to define these spurion transformations. Now, now we can now write the action of QCD. Now we are ready to write it, is with one flavor. It's the gluon action minus the theta term, the one at the beginning that I was saying this is, theta is compatible with zero in nature. The theta term multiplies exactly the operator, the integral of FF tilde. And you can use as discretization of Q exactly what we define as the Jacobian of the chiral transformation, plus the fermion action, which is the Gisbard-Wilson one. Okay? And now we usually define the free energy with theta different from zero. It is defined as the path integral. So the usual with a term, so there is minus SG, minus SF, times e to the I theta q. And usually this is normalized to the same path integral, but without the theta term. Okay, so this is the ratio of the path integral with a theta term and without a theta term. You can also, usually we write also it as e to the I theta q. Okay? Okay, this is just a normalization factor, forget about it. Just remember that when theta equals zero, this is equal to one. Okay, now we can choose for the transformation here, for the axial transformation, we can choose epsilon zero A to be minus the parameter which appear here. So minus theta over two, okay? And we make in the path integral in the numerator, we make this axial transformation here with that parameter, okay? Now, if you do, you see that I have chosen this in such a way that the change of the measure here will cancel exactly the term here, okay? The change in the measure will generate e to the minus I theta q and will cancel exactly this term here. So at the end of the story, you can prove the formula that the original f of theta mm dagger, okay, you can rewrite as the f of 0 times v left m v right dagger and v right m dagger v left dagger, sorry. Okay, so this you can write f 0 m to the I theta and m dagger to e to the minus I theta. So this is the, you see this in many books in the continuum. So what you can take, you can trade off a theta term in the gluonic action by putting a phase in the mass term, okay? And so theta and m will appear in the action or in the free energy only through the combination m to the I theta for one flavor, okay? This is exactly what, now what it's important to stress, and now this is all at the regularized level and there is no trick here, okay? Okay, so now this is a very important relation because this connects now a theory with a theta term and real masses, for if you choose like before, with a theory where there is no theta term but there are complex masses. And now we want to, for the Witten-Veneziano relation, we want to have the topological charge, the topological susceptibility is called. The two-point function integrated or the topological charge is the topological susceptibility. And now you see how you get that. You get from here, you see that if you derive two times with respect to theta here, you bring down two times q, and then you put theta equals 0, and then you get from this part, you derive two times with respect to theta, you put theta equals 0, and you get exactly chi, the topological susceptibility. But on this side here, when you derive with respect to theta, you don't bring down q, but you bring down the mass term in the action. And so this relation here generates a plethora, a chain of ordered entities for the topological susceptibility. So in particular, chi, so if you chi define like 1 over the volume, sum over d theta square of f theta and all the rest, okay, at theta equals 0. And now we use this definition and we derive on this side and on this side, okay? And what we get is the following. We get that a to the fourth sum over x, q of 0. This quantity here is m squared a to the fourth sum of x of p0 x, p0 of 0, minus m s0. Now I will define what are the various terms. And where, again, m is equal to m dagger is equal to m times the identity. S0 is equal to psi left, psi right, plus psi right, psi left. So this is the scalar density. And the singlet scalar density, and p no, p0 is equal psi left psi right minus psi bar right psi left, okay? So these are two singlet pseudoscalar densities. This is a scalar density, okay? And what I had done, try to do the exercise, but there is nothing. I just derived two times with respect to theta. So when you derive two times, you get this term because you bring down two times the mass term, or you bring this term when you derive with respect to theta once theta is already down, okay? It's just a derivative, there is nothing special. Okay, so this is a first worded entity. Now, now, as it's written, this worded entity makes very little sense, okay? Why? Because each of these terms, this is an identity at the regularized level, but each of these terms, when you take the continuum limit, goes to infinity, okay? Each of these terms is not correctly renormalized, okay? And where are the problems? Okay, the first problem is in the condensate here. In fact, if you write psi bar psi, so you write this operator here, you see immediately that S0, the renormalized one, okay, gets a multiplicative renormalization with respect to the bare one. But then this guy here can mix with a term which is m plus m dagger divided a square times the identity. Okay, this is a dimension three operator, has non-trivial chiral transformation under the chiral symmetry, okay, the non-singlet one actually. But what you can prove immediately is that this guy here has a divergence which goes with the square of the cutoff. So in particular, the chiral condensate in QCD is never defined, is never unambiguously defined outside the chiral limit. Because depends, you know, the definition depends on the way you subtract this term here. Okay. So this term here is not defined. In the ultraviolet goes to infinity. Something similar appears to here. But more importantly, also here, this is not defined. And this is not defined because Q is a dimension four operator. Remember, it's f mu nu tilde, so it's dimension four. And now when you take Q of x and Q of zero, and you want to take this integral, in that integral, there is a contribution that comes from when x goes to zero. And this quantity here, when x goes to zero, goes x to the eighth power, because it's four and four, times that entity, okay? Now, when you do the integral in x of, or the sum, in one over x to the eighth, then this is divergent with the fourth power. So if you do this integral here, d for x, one over x to the eighth, with some cutoff, okay, ultraviolet cutoff, okay? This quantity here is divergent with the fourth power of the cutoff, which is also the fourth power of the inverse of the lattice spacing in our case, okay? These are called also the contact terms, I mean the terms that are generated. So this term here also is not defined, okay? This term diverges with the fourth power of the lattice spacing. So in each of these terms there are divergences, and this is a nice word identity, is written as it is, but it's useless at the moment, okay? And this is the reason why, for many, many years, Vito and Veneziano proposed this formula in 79, but until 2004, was not possible to give a precise meaning to this formula, exactly for these divergences here. Okay? Okay, there are questions? Okay, now what we can do, because we will need also this afternoon, we can generalize this symmetry here to the, we can rewrite the chiral non-singlet transformation associated to the other group, okay, to the non-singlet. So those transformations are exactly, we can rewrite exactly in this form here, with the only difference that now this VR and V left will be matrices. So I will not rewrite all this formula, but just remember that V left, for instance, in this case will be e to the e epsilon left a ta, where ta for SU2 is just the Pauli matrices divided by 2, for SU3 is the Gell-Mann matrices divided by 2, and so on, are the generator of the group, okay? And V right is exactly the same with the right, okay? And now you can repeat all what I did here, and you can repeat the transformation that we wrote here for the singlet. And what you get for many, many flavor is that here you get the only modification is divided an f and divided an f here. Okay, so the theta gets divided by an f. This is the only transformation that changed in this relation. And now here, this remains the same, with the only difference that here you get an nf square in the denominator, here you get nf square in the denominator, so it's a square like this. And now the p naught, p0 and s0 now are defined by remembering that psi now is not anymore one fermion field, but will be psi 1, psi nf, okay? So you can use exactly this definition, but remember that now inside this definition, this psi becomes a vector in the flavor space, and so there is a sum over nf of all the components written like this, okay? But otherwise, the formula is exactly like this. Okay. So this is the first formula we need to start with. And now we have to derive another formula. Okay, this I can, okay, let's do. We can use the non-singlet worded entities. So what we do now, so remember this, I have to derive this, now you have put many flavors, but I have used just the rotation under the axial symmetry with the singlet axial symmetry with many flavors, okay? Now I do the same, but for those, for the non-singlet axial symmetry. And now if I do that, and I, so my transformation, the infinitesimal one, will be, first of all, I will choose an axial one. So VL dagger is equal to VR, okay? And this will be in infinitesimal form ATA plus extra term, okay? Now, if you make the Jacobian of this transformation, you will get the trace times gamma 5. Ah, no, sorry, V is written like this, okay, and then when you apply it. Now, when you make the transformation of this, you will get trace of gamma 5 TA, okay? But now the trace of TA is equal to 0 in flavor space, and therefore you get no anomaly. So in this case, there is no anomaly, okay? And now what you get, you say that psi prime is equal to psi plus I epsilon AATA gamma 5 at psi, and psi bar prime is equal to psi bar plus E epsilon AA psi bar gamma 5 at TA. Okay, so you make this transformation with the TA, so it's exactly as before, but now there are these matrices here. And now if you make the variation of the action, what you get is minus A to the fourth I epsilon AA sum over X of psi X TA of what? This you can imagine is gamma 5D plus D gamma 5 at. This is the massless part. Okay, and this goes away for the Gisbert-Wilson relation. And then there is the mass term, which is not invariant. And this is E epsilon AA, sum over X. Okay, we can write all together. Here there is a minus, and E epsilon A, sum over X of what? Of minus psi bar r, anticommutator of TA with m dagger, okay, psi l, plus psi bar left, TA with m, psi right. Okay, this is just algebra, and there is nothing, it's like you do in the continuum. So now we use the usual relation. Now the worded entity you derive exactly in the like in the continuum. So how you derive them? You say that, okay, for somebody that never saw this, you say that you take your operator, and now here, this is the fermion times your, let's write your operator, okay? And now what you do, you make a change of variable following this transformation here. So this becomes prime, and there is no Jacobian because it's a non-singlet one. And here you get a variation of the action which comes from here, so minus delta SF. And depending on the operator, you will get also a variation of the operator, okay? But you know that what you have done here is nothing else than rewriting, okay, the same quantity with different variables, okay? And so this means that this quantity here has to be exact, the integral that comes from here without SF, so bringing down SF has to be equal to O. And so the variation that comes from delta SF when you bring it down, and delta O, this is infinitesimal, so you can bring it down, tells you at the end of the story that delta SF times the original operator has to be equal to the expectation value of the variation of the operator under that symmetry. Okay? This is the standard way to derive the word identities. So now you take this with this variation of the action, and let's see what we get. So I think this we can cancel. So we can choose as an operator O, PB, okay? So this is the pseudo-scalar, but with a flavor matrix in it. So this will be left, right, minus psi right, TB, psi left. Okay, just the pseudo-scalar with flavor index. And then you make the variation of PB under that transformation here. You just apply the transformation before. And what you get is minus I epsilon A of psi left anti-commutator of TA TB psi right plus psi right anti-commutator of TA TB psi left. Okay? And now you put all together, okay, and then you get the following word identity which I write here. At the end of the story, you get 2m times a to the fourth sum over x of pax, pa0, pb0, general, equal to delta ab divided number of flavor times the scalar density. Okay? So these are, you see, they are very similar. This part, okay, it's very similar to this part here, okay? But in the singlet one, on top of the pseudo-scalar and the scalar, there is the anomaly, okay? There is the anomaly that comes from the variation of the measure, okay? While in the non-singlet one, there is no anomaly, and apart trivial factors, this is the word identity that you get. Okay. So now, so what I've done so far for the word identity is something that you can find on the books in the continuum. I mean, this is very, I mean, there's nothing special. But you can redo everything with Gisbert-Wilson. Okay. Now let's look, now we go in the more interesting part. So let's look how they are done, this correlator, and this correlator here, okay? So, for instance, the singlet one, remember that when you have, you know, when you want to compute something like psi bar x, psi zero, oh, sorry, psi x, so this is the scalar operator, for instance, times the scalar operator in zero, okay? So remember, you have a path integral. In the path integral, you can solve the integral over the fermions because the action is quadratic in the fermions. And when you do that, you get the determinant of the operator, which is in the action, times the weak contraction, okay? So here, the weak contraction is of this form, okay? And so what you get here, you get d to the from here, so this will be trace of what? D to the minus one, this is the d that is in the action, from x to zero here, psi, psi bar. And then here you have to change psi with psi bar, so you get a minus sign, okay, times d to the minus one from zero to x, okay? So we always write this something like this, okay? So there is if this is x and this is zero, there is a quad propagator the d to the minus 1 is nothing else than the quark propagator. So there is a quark propagator from x to 0 and a quark propagator from 0 to x. Okay? And now, once you have this contraction, you have to integrate over the gluon field. I mean, you have done the integration over the Grassmann variables, and you have to integrate on the gluon field. So now, let's see how they are done the contraction there. And so there, what we have, for instance, we have P0x, P00. Okay, remember that in P0 there is, okay, here there is the number on I that goes from 1 over n flavor. I, x, gamma 5 in the continuum will be like this. Okay, so there are many flavors here. So these, how you can contract them? So you can contract, there will be nf contractions of the form that I was showing before. Okay? And then there will be plus nf square contractions done like this. Okay? Because when you have psi I gamma 5 psi I, and on this side you have psi j gamma 5 psi j, okay, you can contract psi I with psi j, and there are these contractions, and there are nf on them. Because when you contract I with j, you get a delta I j, and therefore here you have a sum over I and j. With the delta I j, so you get only nf of this term. Then the mass are degenerate, and you get this contraction. Okay, while you can also contract I with I here, and you get this sort of contractions, okay? In this case, you will have nf here, nf there. You make the multiplication, you get nf squared, okay? Now, instead, you can also rewrite PAX of PA0, so the one that appears up in the first worded entity. If you do the same tracciology, then you get 1 half times like this. So there is no nf, and there is the 1 half. The 1 half comes because at some point here we have a trace of ta, ta, which gives you a 1 half, OK? Oh, now I'm doing this part of the demonstration with a contraction because it's easier. You could avoid this with two or three blackboards of computation, OK? But in this way, it's just easier to show it. Now you see what happened. You see that in this term here and in this term here, there is exactly the same contraction that is here, with the only difference of the coefficient in front. Okay? So now so this worded entity here is telling you that you can remove the condensate that was divergent by replacing it by this contraction here. But this contraction here is nothing else that this contraction here, okay? So at the end, in the second equation, you will have this part of the contraction which come, so you will have, here you will have the condensate, but the condensate through this relation you replace with the contraction, with this contraction here, and then you will have the contraction that come from here, which are of both types, okay? Now, if you do the algebra, the magic of this is that this worded entity here gets replaced by q of x of q of 0 equal to m square a to the fourth sum over x of pi I x pj j 0 with I different from j, where pi I is nothing else of psi I left, psi I right, minus psi bar I right, psi I left, where now there is no summation over I, okay? And here there is no summation over J. So you see what happened. By putting together this equation with this equation, what we have shown is that the topological susceptibility, let's write like this, it's equal, okay, apart a trivial factor, it's proportional, okay, to contraction made only by this. Okay? So this is the magic that happens. So when you use the non-singlet worded entity, you replace the condensate with this contraction, you put in the second equation, and the combination of those contraction and those in the second equation goes away, and you're left only with this. Okay? This is what happened, and this is the first step of a plethora that now we will see. We will see some of them of worded entity. So for the moment, so we can remove completely this part here, and sorry, the second equation, we can replace with this and still keep the first one. There are questions? Yes.
Can you, so that everybody can hear the question.
Word identities result from symmetries.
Yes.
And you introduced spurions, not symmetries, and
yes.
Resulted and got the word identities. But
yes.
Is correct?
Yeah. If you remember, when I derived this, I introduced spurions just to derive in an easy way the word identities. Here, I never used spurions. I rotated the action, and I kept track of the variation of the action. Okay. So I use, in one case, spurion, in the other, you can use spurion in both cases and so on. But as far as you keep correctly the variation either of the spurion or the term of the action, these worded entities are correct. Okay, so this is a worded entity in the same theory. Okay, you can derive through the spurion, so that is a mathematical trick. But this is a worded entity in your theory with a given M and so on. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay, so now what is the, where we want to go? This is maybe the most difficult part of these lectures, eh? So, and something that you don't find. So where we want to go now, you see that I said at the beginning that this is a power divergent quantity with 1 over a to the fourth, and this is still, you can prove that also this is the same. It's a power divergent quantity, it's written as it is. I mean, it's a power divergent. So again, it's not a very useful relation, how it is written now. So now we still iterate the non-singlet worded entities. And if you remember, I rewrite here, the variation of the action, the one that I just wrote before, you can summarize it by E epsilon A times 2 times the mass. If you remember, there were 2 commutators there, times A to the fourth, sum over X. Of PAX. I mean, the one that I just wrote before, you can write, when the mass are degenerate, you can write this way. Okay, and now you do exactly the same transformation I was doing before, but then you do for delta, okay, let's take as an operator now an interpolating operator SB. Okay, this is the scalar density, so it's psi bar left, TB psi right plus psi bar right TB psi left. Okay? And now we can take the variation of this operator here. You just use the transformation that I wrote before. And now you see that this variation is minus I epsilon AA of psi bar left, anti-commutator, because it's axial, TB, psi right, minus psi left, psi right, anti-commutator, TA, TB, psi left. You see, when you make an axial transformation, you transform a scalar in a pseudo-scalar, and vice versa. Okay? Okay, now we choose, in this transformation, now the epsilon A that we had before, for instance, for SU3 goes from 1 to 8 and so on. Now we choose epsilon A, different from 0, only for the first 3 generators. So the generator 1, 2, and 3. So are the 3 generators that makes the SU2 transformation in the first 2 flavors. Okay, so let's make a transformation like this and choose this particular combination. Now you realize immediately that TATB, whatever is an F, you can write as delta AB divided by 2, and is a matrix with all zeros. Okay? except one in the diagonal entries there. Okay. And now let's take as an interpolating operator for our worded entities, the non-singlet one, we take the product of the scalar density x that I just rotated here times a pseudo-scalar density, and let's suppose to have for the moment five flavors, okay? And then the fourth flavor with at the point x4. And here I call it point x2. You will understand why I do. Okay? Now, we take the variation of the operator delta O is so that, first of all, it's the variation of this operator times this operator plus this operator times the variation of this operator. But the variation of this operator is zero because this acts, as I choose it, it acts only on the first three flavors. So this has the fourth flavor, so it doesn't rotate. The variation is zero. So we have only to take the variation of this operator here. But the variation is given by this, with this matrix here. So at the end of the story, the variation of the operator is minus I epsilon AA divided by 2 of P11 x2 plus P22 x2 times P44 x4. Okay? Because here I get the trace of this and I get that. Now, so the worded entity now we can write as delta SF times O is equal to delta O. Okay? The usual worded entity, blah blah blah. So let's write now with this choice. And now with this choice, what we get, apart trivial factors, is m a to the fourth times x1 of p12 so we take the variation which is it gets a, and now when we take this rotation you have to choose a different from zero only in this form. Sorry, let's do it better. Let's do. So you get 2m a to the fourth of what? Of x1 of, now the variation of the action, which is pa x1. So here, okay, the variation of the action. And then you get sb, then the operator, sb x2, p44 x4. This strange number, you will understand. So you see what I've done here, the variation of the operator, I remove epsilon a in front, okay? So the variation of the operator, you get just 2m pa, the variation of the action, times the operator, which is just this one. Okay, I've done nothing particular. And now, this, the worded entity is telling you that this has to be equal to the variation of the operator itself. And so this quantity here, it's 1 half of P11 plus P22 times P44 that doesn't rotate, okay? So this is just exactly the non-singlet worded entity that I wrote to derive that one, but what I changed with respect to that one is just the interpolating operator. In that one, we have chosen the pseudo-scalar one. In this, we have chosen a product of these two. I mean, nothing else. And the rest is algebra, okay? But now this is an extremely interesting worded entity. Why is it extremely interesting? Now, if you choose A and B different here, you see that the only contraction that appear here, this is a non-singlet contraction. So, here, the only contraction which enter a part trivial factor is the contraction make like this, okay? times, sorry, times the P44, times this, okay? So this is x1, x2. There is an A and B. Remember that the trace of TA and trace of TB is equal to zero, so there are no singlet contraction. So the only contraction you have here is the one like this plus the blob which comes from this, okay? But this is equal to one half of what? Of a contraction like this plus a contraction like this, which multiply a contraction like this. So P44 contracts like this. And this is just a sum of two contractions which for the general quarks are the same. So you can remove the one half, and this is just like this, okay? So you see that I can trade off a product of two disconnected contractions that I had here in the topological susceptibility, with the product of, now there are three density here, and one which is contracted not in a singlet way, it's contracted like this, and the other is a singlet contraction, okay? And again, I repeat, to do that, I use nothing that the non-anomalous worded entities, okay? With this operator as a probe operator of the worded entity, okay? And now you see the trick. I mean, so you start with this, and you end up with this one, and now I can iterate it. And so I can prove at the end the following fundamental formula. So I iterate once again, and then I can prove the formula, which is a to the fourth sum over x of q of x, q of zero, okay? And this formula can be written as m to the fifth, a to the 16, as what? Sum over 1 up to 4 of P12 S23 S31 and P45 S54. Okay, and here there is X1, X2, X3, X4, and X5. Okay, X5 I put to 0, just okay, this is the crucial formula. Why is a crucial formula? So you see what tells you this formula. It tells you that apart trivial factors, you had here your topological susceptibility, and this is equal to m to the fifth times a product of two density, a product of density chains. So the first one is just written like this, where you put a pseudoscalar, a scalar, and a scalar. And the second one is just like this, with pseudoscalar and scalar, okay? So what you have done here is that you say that, again, we didn't use any anomalous transformation. The anomalous transformation was used only at the beginning for the first equation. But this relation is obtained only through non-anomalous transformation, okay? You just have to iterate twice what I wrote here. Now, this is an extremely interesting formula because now you can say, okay, let's look at this formula and let's look if there are power divergences when two of these coordinates, or three of them, or four of them, go together, okay? Because we say that here, just by power counting, there should be a quartic divergence. But now let's take, for instance, the first. And now we take P12 of X1 times S23 of X2, and we take the limit where X1 minus X2 goes to zero, okay? And now, if you take this limit here, then this is a dimension three operator, and it has two flavor indices that don't match, one and three, okay? So it's pseudoscalar, is dimension six, and it has two flavor indices. What is the lowest dimensional operator with these indices? It's a pseudoscalar with index 1, 3, with coordinate, for instance, x1, and times 1 over x1 minus x2 to the power, to the cubic power, okay? Because it's dimension 6, dimension 3, this has the flavor structure, so the Wilson coefficient, in the operator product expansion, is x1 minus x2 to the power 3, okay? Now it's important to realize that the operator product expansion at the leading order in the divergent series is a non-perturbative statement. It's not something that the higher order term you need to use perturbation theory, but at the leading term here, the leading term is a non-perturbative statement. Now you see that if you now make the integral, for instance, over x1 of this guy here, the integral of d for x1 of a divergent which goes like 1 over x cube, this is not divergent anymore. Okay, so what you need here is a divergent of d4, for instance, x1, of 1 over x1 minus x2 cube, okay? But now this is a convergent integral, okay? Because this, that, sorry, here I put 2, just 2, you can put what, one of the 2. So this integral, it's just convergent. That's so if you cut off it on a regularization, it doesn't produce any ultraviolet divergence, okay? And now you can repeat as an exercise what I did here by putting all this, okay, this point to this and so on, and then putting 3 points together, 4 points together, and you will realize that you will never generate any power divergence. So the power here of divergence will be always lower than the power suppressed by the integration here, okay? And so this proves at the end of the story that here you couldn't prove with Gisbert-Wilson fermion, you couldn't prove that this has no ultraviolet divergent, because if you just do the OP there, then you get 1 over x to the 8, and this quantity has 1 over x to the 8 there. I mean, but it's a 1 over x to the 8, so that when you do the integral, it vanish, okay? The divergence vanish, and it vanished thanks to this word identity, okay? So now, the other 2 minutes. Can I take 2 minutes? So the other bonus of this formula here, okay, is that now you can forget to use Gisbert-Wilson. And you can use, you know, as a definition of your chi, this is just chi, the one that it's needed in the Witten-Veneziano formula. The definition of chi now, you can forget this one, which is problematic one, and you can use this one. And now you can repeat what I have done. And if you see what I have done, I never used the fact that in studying the divergences, I never used the fact that I had exact chiral symmetry. So in particular, this formula you can use for Wilson fermions, for instance, and it has no divergences. So in this sense, this is a universal formula, much better than this, okay? Because this, it doesn't have divergences only if you use Q, which come from Gisbert-Wilson, so from the transformation of the measure. Instead, this formula here is finite, whatever fermions you use, okay? And so in this sense, this is a universal formula, and this is the one that you had to use in the Witten-Veneziano relation. Okay, thank you.